All right. Last tag of the year. YYA974.
Good luck. Gotta go a little bit farther than that to get to Mexico. Hello, everybody. I'm Rich Lund, just a guy trying to help out the Monarchs. And we've got a lot to talk about today. On September 11th, 2018, the world of monarch-raising enthusiasts was shaken up a bit by two statements released by two different monarch conservation groups, the Monarch Joint Venture and also the Xerces Society. They were about the same topic, more or less, and though they were handled in slightly different tones, the broad picture, main idea, is that it's been pulled into question whether or not rearing monarchs, is it something that helps the population? Is it something that does nothing for the population? Is it something that actually might hurt the population that we're actually trying to help? Within just a few days, these two statements were brought to my attention, along with people letting me know about many different blog posts and message board discussion forums, places where a lot of very heated debates were happening. And so of this group of people, where we all have the same goal in mind, to help increase the population of the North American monarch butterfly to a sustainable population, there have been many different interpretations of these statements, support for them, stark rebuttals of them, everything under the sun. And these different sources of support and blog posts and rebuttals are ranging from just your average monarch enthusiast to people who have been doing this for 20, 30 years, and also including some of the experts that are within this field. And we're dealing with a situation where some of the experts are not at all agreeing with each other. And some of the takes on this, some of the opinions, are ranging from one extreme of the sky is falling, do not do this, all the way over to the other extreme of this is not a big deal at all and you can ignore it. Meanwhile, there are people like us, you and me, who are rearing wild-found monarch eggs and caterpillars to adults, and we're trying to make sense of all of this and figure out, so what exactly does all this mean? Should we continue? Should we stop? What's the deal? What are the concerns that they're bringing up, and how concerning are these concerns? Are there any deal breakers here? And so ever since these statements came out, along with the multitude of blog posts and discussions and everyone's in a tizzy, people have been asking me, hey, Rich, what's your take on this? How do you weigh in? Well, here it comes, but first let's get a few things straight. First off, I am not an expert. I am not an authority on monarch butterflies, and I do not claim to be. Number two, I have a tremendous amount of respect for the Monarch Joint Venture and for the Xerces Society and for any conservation group that is out there trying to help the monarch butterfly populations. They do a lot of hard work. They have, in often cases, committed their life's work to helping out the monarch butterfly. And just because people disagree sometimes does not mean that we shouldn't always remember we all have the same goal in mind. Let's treat each other with respect and civility. But number three, a claim, no matter who is making it, is only as strong as the evidence that is being used to support that claim. Nothing in science is immune to questioning. So if at any time during this video it kind of sounds like I'm disagreeing with one or more things that these statements have said, understand that it's not really that I'm disagreeing. It's better said that I remain unconvinced. There's a difference between saying I agree, from I disagree, from I don't agree yet. And maybe I always remain unconvinced. The point is, if you're going to convince me, we need to see the evidence. And if that evidence never gets brought up, then I don't agree yet. With that in mind, the two groups that released these two statements, they handled this topic a little bit differently from each other. Monarch Joint Venture really posted this as a question. Raising monarchs, why or why not? And what that blog post really seemed to be was plenty of concerns that should be considered if you are thinking about rearing monarchs and why maybe they feel a choice to rear monarchs isn't the best one. They express concerns, but also they are still providing information on how they recommend rearing monarchs at home if you're choosing to do that. I think that they had a very worthy and very level-headed approach to all of this. Respect. The Xerces Society statement was a bit more definitive. They didn't pose the topic as a question, should we or shouldn't we, but instead came right out and pretty much said what their stance was. The title of their blog post is Keep Monarchs Wild: Why Captive Rearing Isn't the Way to Help Monarchs. I will point out, they do still offer, though, at the bottom of their post, their recommendations for how you could rear monarchs responsibly. I've put the links to these two blog posts down in the description below, and I do urge you to fully read them before you continue on with this video, so that way you understand the context of the things that are being discussed. Before we go further, let's bring up two terms that are going to be important for this discussion. There's a difference between what I'll call wild-rearing monarchs and captive-bred monarchs. Wild-reared monarchs are the kind of monarchs that I've been showing in these Raising Monarch videos. It's where you have found an egg or a caterpillar in the wild, you have brought that into a controlled environment at home, and you're helping it get to the adult stage. And then once it makes it to the adult stage, you promptly release it. That is a wild-reared monarch. Captive-bred monarchs, though, those would be ones that are produced by some type of breeding program, where a human has selected which boy and girl monarch are going to mate, and then that produced eggs, which they then rear to adulthood. In some breeding programs, they might release them right after that, but in others, they keep some of those individuals that were reared through their program, and they mate those as well, hopefully avoiding inbreeding situations. So when I say wild-reared, or I say captive-bred, you understand that there's a difference there. Okay, that said, let's keep going. The concerns that are raised, and why at least one of these two groups is saying we just should not be doing this, really I would say fall into about three categories. Concerns about disease, concerns about the genetics, and then concerns about resources. Let's look at diseases first. When it comes to having concerns about the diseases, I agree, this is something that we need to take notice of and be considering. But I wouldn't say that it's a reason to not do it. I would say that it's a reason to be responsible if you're going to do it. If you are rearing monarchs, understand that in nature, most monarch caterpillars, they develop into an adult without probably ever coming into contact with another monarch caterpillar. We can't really usually say the same thing if we're doing a rearing program. Quite often, we've got multiple monarch caterpillars in the same container. But you want to try to keep that number down. As with any population, as the population density increases, the risk for infection or disease and an outbreak of that infection or disease increases. And when it comes to this concern of disease and parasites and infections, it's not just about your monarchs that you're rearing at home and whether or not they're going to make it, but what if they do make it with this disease and you release them out into the wild where they can spread these diseases, infections, parasites to the wild population? Things like bacterial infections, NPV, which is a type of virus, and the OE parasite, those are the three big ones. And these are topics that I've brought up in many previous videos, especially how to prevent them, and in the case of OE parasites, how to test for that infection. But the question really is, are these concerns a deal breaker? Because infections and outbreaks can happen, does that mean that we should just not be doing this? I would say no, because they're quite preventable. To be honest, as I read these two statements, it kind of seemed like it was in the category of don't raise monarchs or teach people how to do it because some people are going to be irresponsible and muck it up. I think it's very good that both of these groups are voicing these concerns and getting people to think more about it. But I don't think that it's a reason to call it quits. Just be responsible. Keep things clean. Proper sanitation, bleach treating of eggs, bleach treating of leaves, and testing for OE parasites and not releasing if they are found to have OE parasites seems to take care of just about all of this. Next up, genetic concerns. By rearing monarchs, are we changing the gene pool in some significant and or in some negative way? This is where the difference between captive-bred and wild-reared monarchs is very important. Both sources bring up the idea that when certain species are captive-bred, part of breeding programs, and reintroduced into the wild, that they are less suited to survive in the wild. Monarch Joint Venture cited a 2008 study that describes this quite well, and I fully agree with that idea. That study showed pretty definitively that when you have generations that are raised in a certain different environment than nature, they will adapt very quickly to those different conditions. What that means is that if you're selecting monarchs to mate and then lay eggs, and then you raise those individuals, and from those individuals, the ones that make it, you then select adults, not brother and sister, of course, and have them mate and produce offspring, that after just a few generations, they're going to be very well suited to survive your breeding program, but not necessarily best suited to survive Mother Nature. Now, there could be an entire video about how large or how small of a concern this is, how big or how small of a problem this could be. And strong concerns of inbreeding, if it's not done carefully, certainly exist. But you may have noticed, in my video series, I have never talked about breeding monarchs. I have very much steered clear of that topic. This is the first time I've ever even mentioned it. No monarchs in any of my videos that I've ever shown have been monarchs involved with a breeding program. I think there are definitely ways of doing it responsibly, but I think that those ways are best left to those in academics, in universities, where they have proper laboratory procedures and are very careful about which ones they select for mating, so that way they can definitely avoid the risk of inbreeding, and they're selecting in ways that keep the gene pool fresh. So I'm not saying that I'm against breeding, but I think that there's so many larger risks involved with it that it's really something best left to the experts, people who are doing it for scientific research purposes. But still, bottom line, there's a difference between captive-bred monarchs and wild-reared monarchs. And both the Xerces Society statement and the Monarch Joint Venture statement, they are raising these concerns about genetics when it comes to captive-bred monarchs. If you are rearing wild monarchs, so you're taking in wild eggs or caterpillars from nature, when you take them into your program, obviously you're not changing their genetics. And when you release them as adults, they have the same genetics as they did when you took them in. So if you want these genetic concerns to also be pretty much a non-issue, don't breed. Leave such things to the experts at universities who are equipped with proper laboratory procedures and standards. The third major concern, and one that I fully agree with, is the idea of resources. In fact, I agree with this so much that in part 5 of the original core of the series, part 1 through 5, at the very end, I give a very special message, I called it. I explain that if we are raising monarchs to try to help the population, that work doesn't really amount to anything if the monarchs don't have more milkweed to come back to. Our best evidence suggests that the monarch population is declining because of a loss of habitat, specifically of milkweed to lay the eggs on, and food for the caterpillars. If you decide in a given summer that you're going to take in 50 wild eggs and rear those to adults, and you convince 10 of your friends and family to do the same, and they convince 10 of their friends and family to do the same, and this starts catching on faster than that fidget spinner fad from a few years ago, all we've actually done is just made a larger population that still does not have enough food for their babies. And if anything, we've actually made this situation worse now because we've increased the population that now still has the same amount of food, which already wasn't enough. And so that food is now going to be even more strained amidst the population that is now even larger. If a lack of resources is what's causing a population decline, trying to boost the population is not going to be the logical way to actually solve the problem. And so this has been part of the message of this video series the entire time, but even I'm willing to admit, looking back at like the last 2 years of videos, I haven't really been voicing this as often or as loudly as I should be. The number one way to help the monarch butterfly population is to plant milkweed. If you're willing to raise the monarchs, you've got to be willing to plant the milkweed. It's even less work and less of a commitment. Whether that means planting it in your front or backyard, or getting involved with the community, having it planted in certain park areas, schools, courthouses, municipalities, recreational areas, wherever it can be done. It helps them out. With disease concerns, keep things clean and sanitary. Bleach treat eggs, bleach treat leaves. Test for OE parasites. When it comes to genetic concerns, just don't breed monarchs. Leave that to academia. Leave it to the people that are doing it for scientific research and have laboratory conditions. With resource concerns, plant milkweed. And if you're encouraging others to raise monarchs, make sure that you're encouraging them to plant milkweed as well. That's the real message we gotta spread. I'm Rich Lund. The sky is not falling. But also, these concerns are something that we should not ignore, but instead should very much take to heart. Thanks for checking this out, and thank you very much for doing what you can to help out the monarch butterfly. And plant milkweed. Catch you later.